King, and we are continuing our teaching series on the Holy Spirit and His gifts. Today's lesson and topic is 7 steps to receiving the Holy Ghost. Let's first look at 2 scripture references. The first one is found in John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, and it reads, "I will pray the Father, and He shall send you another Comforter, that He may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it sees Him not, neither know Him. But you know Him, for He dwell with you and shall be in you." And then let's look at Acts chapter 2, verses 32 through 33. "This Jesus has God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, He has shared forth this which you now see and hear." Dear heart, there's a twofold purpose to this lesson, 7 steps to receiving the Holy Ghost. Number 1 is to help those who have not yet received the infilling or the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And number 2 is to help Spirit-filled believers pray with those who are seeking to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, any layperson can take the following 7 steps and help any Christian get filled with the Holy Ghost without any tarrying or waiting. And I just want to share with you a little brief testimony of how these 7 steps was written and by whom. Now, the 7 steps to receiving the Holy Ghost were written by Prophet Kenneth Hagin. He said that he was one time preaching in a certain meeting where about 65 people had been filled with the Holy Ghost. And then in one of the daytime services, someone asked him, "Well, Prophet Hagin, what are we going to do when you leave?" Because they never had so many people to get filled with the baptism so quick without tarrying or waiting. So they wanted to ask Prophet Hagin, "When you leave, what are we going to do?" So in other words, you know, they just didn't know how it could be done so quickly. And then Prophet Hagin said that the reason why the people asked him that question, because they have known people that have struggled in order to get filled with the Holy Spirit. Some people hadn't been filled 15, 20 years. So Prophet Hagin, what he did, he got one of the women who was an outstanding altar worker, and he showed her the instruction. And before he showed her the instructions, she told him that in every meeting, she always prayed with people to receive the Holy Spirit and until her throat sometimes just gives out. And sometimes she would even get laryngitis for a whole month because she would just struggle to get people filled with the Holy Spirit. So this is when Prophet Hagin, by the Holy Spirit, always remember now, the Word of God is given to us by the Holy Spirit. Inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He reveals the Word of God to us. He leads us into all truth. So what he did for Prophet Hagin, he led him into the Word of God and how to get people filled or baptized in the Holy Spirit without waiting or tarrying. So Prophet Hagin told them about the 7 steps to receiving the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And then that night, 7 believers came forward to receive the Holy Ghost. But he, Prophet Hagin, didn't pray for them. Since he told those people how to do it, he stepped back and he let them pray for the sick who came forth for healing. And then he sent one of the 7 people into a prayer room telling the altar workers, "All right, go back there and get them filled following the instruction I had given you earlier today." Now that is truly a teacher. I like that. He was teaching God's children to have hands-on experience. He did not feel that he needed to do it. He wanted them to learn how to do it because he knew he had to go back where he came from. That is truly an apostle and a prophet. Praise the living God. So these altar workers, they went to the room and came out in 10 minutes with six of the seven being filled with the Holy Ghost. And then they apologized for not getting the seventh one filled, but it turned out that that seventh person wasn't even a Christian. Because remember, the prerequisite for receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit, you must be born again. You must receive Jesus into your heart as your Lord and your Savior. So that's the reason why that seventh person didn't get filled, because they was not even a Christian, didn't want to be a Christian. So therefore, you know, that person couldn't be filled with the Holy Spirit, because you can't get the Holy Ghost without getting saved first. Now, one of the altar workers was so excited to learn how to help people receive the Holy Ghost without waiting or tarrying. She just could hardly wait to go visit her mother, who lived some distance away from her, and she wanted to help her mother get filled with the Holy Ghost, because she said her mother has been seeking for 19 years. Now, that's a long time, but she knew now how to get her mother filled. So she wanted to visit her mother. So several months later, Prophet Hagin was invited back to that same church to hold meetings again, and he saw the woman. And she gave Prophet Hagin her testimony. She said, "Prophet Hagin, I drove about 150 miles to my mother's house, and Mama was outside waiting for me. And I said, 'Mama, just come on in into the house. I can't stay long. I'm going to have to get back home. I only have time to tend to the business I came for, which is to get you filled with the Holy Ghost.' Then her mama said, 'Now, you know I've been seeking a mighty long time.' And she said, 'Mama, I know. I know you've been seeking my long time, but this time, Mama, you shall receive.' So she said, her and her mother went into the house, and she told her mother to sit down and open her Bible to Acts chapter 2. When they sat down on the seat, she sat next to her mother, and she spent 10 minutes with her mother just sharing her out of the Word of God, Acts chapter 2. Then after they finished, she said she just lovingly and gently laid her hands on her mother, and her mother received the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues just that quick after waiting and tarrying for 19 years. Why? Because of the seven steps that Prophet Hagin had given her to help those be filled with the Holy Spirit without waiting and tarrying. And every step comes from the Word of God, Acts chapter 2. So now let's begin with step number one. And remember now, these steps are the same steps with Prophet and Apostle Hagin used in his revival meeting across the country to get people filled with the Holy Ghost. And dear heart, he have a good track record. That's one thing when a person have a good track record, which is showing them being honorable in the Word of God. And it is proven that these seven steps do work because they are straight from the Word of God. Like I said, it's one thing when someone that have gotten the evidence or track record to show what they have been telling you, it had been manifested in their ministry. That's the reason why when certain ones call themselves certain offices, apostles and prophets, you know, just look at their track record. By their fruit, you shall know them. Praise God. So step number one, help the believers to see that God has already given the Holy Spirit and that it is now up to that person to receive God's free gift. Above everything else, help the believer see that he is not to beg God to fill him with the Holy Spirit. Remember now, the promise that the Holy Spirit was to be given was fulfilled in Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and he has been here ever since. After that time, God hasn't given the Holy Spirit to anyone because he was already sent. When you give a person a gift, you already gave them the gift. Now, people simply have to now receive the Holy Spirit. Just like you give a person a gift, you're the giver, so you give it to them, but it's up to the person to receive the gift. So the Holy Spirit was given to us, which is found in John, Acts chapter 2, verses 32 to 33, and also really John chapter 14, 16, and 17. It's the promise of the Father, which he shed forth in our heart, which we now see and hear. So the Holy Spirit have already been given, which is the baptism of the Holy Spirit, on the day of Pentecost, the gift of the Father, the promise of the Father, which is the Holy Spirit. The baptism or the infilling of the Holy Spirit was given on the day of Pentecost. For instance, let's look at what the Apostle Paul said some years after the incidents recorded in Acts chapter 2. Now, this was some years after the day of Pentecost that Paul spoke these words. So look at Acts chapter 19, verses 1 through 6. Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples. He said unto them, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" He didn't say, "Has God given you the Holy Ghost?" He didn't say, "Have God given you the Holy Ghost?" He said, "Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed?" That means since you was converted. And they said unto him, "We have not so much." And Paul said, "Receive," that means the baptism, dear hearts. You know, that means the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And they said unto him, "We have not so much as heard, rather, there be any Holy Ghost." And he said unto them, "Unto what then were you baptized?" And they said, "Unto John's baptism." Then Paul said, "John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto the people that they should believe on him which shall come after him, that is on Christ Jesus." When they heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And when Paul had laid his hands upon them, remember, see now, they was baptized in the name of Lord Jesus. They was already saved, but Paul did a second step. And what did Paul do? He laid his hands upon them. The Holy Ghost came on them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. You know, Paul didn't tell the disciples to pray that God would give them the Holy Ghost. He didn't do that. He said, "Have you received since you believed?" The Bible says the Holy Ghost came on them and they spoke with tongues and prophesied, Acts 19:6. Notice also Acts chapter 8, which occurs some years after the day of Pentecost. And we're going to read Acts chapter 8, verses 14 and 15. Now, when the apostles which were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God concerning salvation, dear heart. And again, when we receive the word of God, that means we have received God's word in our heart and we believe, therefore we are converted, we are saved. Because it's with the heart man believe unto salvation, the mouth he confessed. They sent unto them Peter and John. Now verse 15 say, who, when they came down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. That's the baptism or the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Now again, the apostles didn't pray that God would give the Samaritans the Holy Ghost. They prayed that they might receive, because the gift has already been given. Now it's just a manner of receiving him. They prayed that they might receive the Holy Ghost. So what did they do? They laid their hands on them and they did receive the Holy Spirit. That's Acts chapter 8 verse 17, which is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So God hasn't given the Holy Ghost to anyone since the day of Pentecost. He don't keep giving the same gift. Let's keep giving. No, the gift has already been given. Now it's a matter of us receiving. See, it's out of the Father's hand. He did his part. Now we must do our part in receiving him. So we need to receive him, because the Holy Ghost is already here for believers to receive. So what is the first step to receiving the Holy Ghost? Is to teach others that they don't have to pray to God to give them the Holy Ghost, because he was given on the day of Pentecost. What they need to do now is to receive him. Just like a gift, when someone gives me a gift, the gift has already been given. I just need to receive the gift. I don't have to pray and beg for them to give me the gift, because they already given me the gift. I just need to be humble and willing in receiving it. So that's step number one. So step number two, show the person who has come to receive the Holy Ghost that anyone who is saved is ready to immediately receive the Holy Spirit. They don't have to wait. They don't have to tarry. They don't have to get their act together. If you are saved, you are a candidate in immediately receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. So let's look at Acts chapter 2, verses 37 and 38. Now when they, the unsaved multitude who gathered as a result of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and to whom Peter had preached, quoting Joel's prophecy. Now remember now, Peter is speaking to an unsaved multitude. When they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brother, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sin, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now notice in verse 38, shows us that anyone who is saved is immediately ready to receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Some people think that there are certain things they have to do to qualify to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. For example, some think they have to make restitution for past sins. You know, there was a person in the East Texas that once said, I had to return a pig that I had stolen before I could get the Holy Ghost. Now, it is true that sin which has not been confessed can hinder people from receiving the blessings of God. Now, however, if people are saved and walking in fellowship with God, they couldn't possibly be any cleaner than they are right then. Once we confess our sins, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And you find it in 1 John 1 chapter verse 9. I believe that saved people go to heaven when they die, and if they are good enough to go to heaven, they are good enough to have a little bit of heaven in them here on earth. And then some people think they have to follow a certain standard of dress in order to receive the Holy Spirit. For example, one time, Prophet Hagin was preaching at a certain place, and in a meeting, a woman came forward to receive the Holy Spirit. She did receive and spoke with tongues for 15 or 20 minutes. Then she decided to sit down. She started praising God in her English, her native tongue. Well, this one guy walked over to her and thought she hadn't received because he hadn't heard her speaking in tongues. He also knows that she was wearing a wedding ring. And he said to this lady, sister, if you would take off that wedding band, God would fill you with the Holy Ghost. Dear hearts, we need to be careful about that. It don't have nothing to do with what you have on. All it have to do with your heart. If you have already confessed your sins to the Lord, he has forgiven you, then you are an immediate candidate to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It don't matter what you got on, dear heart. But anyway, Prophet Hagin whispered to that in the ears of that young fellow. He said, "Brother, you are too late. She had already been filled, wedding band and all." Christ, you know, he had to make a joke out of it. You see, some people have the mistaken idea that they have to court God's favor in order to get him to do something for them, when all we have to do is be saved and walk in the light of salvation. A person who is out of fellowship with God, of course, will have to come back into fellowship with him. Some people have imagined that one has to be perfect before he can get the Holy Ghost. However, even the great Apostle Paul said he wasn't perfect, yet we know he had the Holy Ghost. Dear heart, Satan, we say anything to you to get you not to believe in receiving the free gift of the Holy Ghost. So, because he knows once you receive the Holy Spirit, then he will come upon you and power will be given to you to be a witness for your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So if you are saved, you have already confessed your sins to Jesus Christ, then you right there is an immediate candidate to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So let's look at Philippians chapter 3, verse 12 and 13. "Not as though I had already attained," and this is what Paul is saying, "either were already perfect." But Paul said, "I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do," and we know we have some example from the Word of God of some things that Paul did before his conversion. But Paul said, "This one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before." If you are wanting to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the enemy have the tendency to bring up your path, you need to do as Paul have done. You need to say what Paul have said. You need to say to yourself, "There's one thing I do, I forget those things which are behind, and I reach forth." That means keep your eyes looking ahead and stop looking back. "I keep looking ahead unto those things which are before me." And right now what is before you is receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. Don't look back at the past. That is the enemy trying to bring unbelief and doubt into your heart so that you won't receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But do as Paul. Look forth. Keep your eyes looking ahead to those things what the Lord has presented unto you or before you, which is receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. If we could do everything we ought to do and be everything we ought to be without the Holy Spirit, then what will we need the Holy Spirit for? I mean, if I can go back and do things much better and then come in and receive the Holy Spirit, then why would you need the Holy Spirit? If I can do everything for myself, then why would I need the Holy Ghost? You know, carnal Christian or Christian who are sense ruled or dominated by the flesh, those are carnal Christians. They're not Christians that walk by the Holy Spirit. Now, they can be filled with the Holy Ghost. How do we know that? Because the Bible says the Corinthian Christians were carnal. And yet Paul prayed for them that they would come behind in no gift. That 1 Corinthians 1:7. He was not endorsing carnality now. He wasn't doing that. He was trying to get them to grow up in God and outgrow carnality. Or outgrow being ruled or dominated by their senses and by their flesh. He was trying to get them to walk by faith and not by sight. But as believers yield to him, which is God, to the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost will help them grow out of carnality. Baby Christians can be filled with the Holy Spirit. Carnal Christians and baby Christians indeed, all believers greatly need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, because then they will receive power that will help them, according to Acts 1:8. Also, if they will walk in the light of God's word and be led by the Holy Spirit, he will lead them into all truth and help them to outgrow some things in their life which have perhaps hindered their Christian walk. John chapter 16, verse 13. Therefore, if a person who is saved, he is ready to receive the Holy Ghost, whether you are a carnal Christian or a baby Christian, you are saved, you are ready to receive the Holy Ghost. Always lead a believer who is seeking the Holy Ghost to see that truth. You don't tell a baby or carnal Christian, no, you first got to grow up before you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That's nonsense. If he could do that on his own, why would he need the Holy Spirit? Leadership and guidance. Because the Holy Spirit, he's the one who helps us and mature us in the Word of God as we are led by him. Because the scriptures say those who are led by the Holy Spirit are the sons of God. So baby Christians and carnal Christians, they are believers too. Matter of fact, that's who we are. When we first start, that's who we are. We are baby Christians and we are carnal Christians, because some things we do according to what we see off sight, and we are sense ruled. We are candidates for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and we need him so that we can develop into mature Christians. Praise the living God. So step number two to receiving the Holy Ghost is to show the person who has come to receive the Holy Ghost that anyone who is saved, doesn't matter if you're a baby Christian or a carnal Christian, you are ready immediately to receive the Holy Spirit. Matter of fact, you need him immediately, because we need to grow to become mature children of God. So step number three, tell people that when you lay hands on them, they are to receive the Holy Ghost. Not to pray and ask for the Holy Ghost, but to receive. Now, anyone can lay hands on another believer in faith. For God, he always honors faith. However, now, there is also a ministry of laying on of the hands. And some are used along these lines more than others, because that is their ministry. Everybody is not called to the ministry of laying on of hands. Only specific one. Even when you look at the apostles, they had a tendency to send Peter and John. Not all apostles did they send to lay hands on believers to receive the Holy Spirit. It was always Peter and John. And then later on, you hear Paul doing the same thing. That is the ministry that the Holy Spirit had given them to do. That was a gift the Holy Spirit had given them to lay hands on believers. But everybody do not have it. But in faith, we can lay hands on other believers to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So anyone can lay their hands on a person in faith as a point of contact and tell them, this is the time right now that you are to receive the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is received by faith, and faith is always now or present tense. Hebrews 11 chapter verse 1. So again, everyone, which is a lay person, a believer, in faith as a point of contact, can lay their hands on a believer to receive the Holy Spirit. And then that person need to tell the one who's going to receive to receive. That don't mean that you go around laying hands on everybody because you're not called or you have not been given the gift of laying on of hands to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And you know, the Holy Spirit bringing back to my remembrance, I was in this church when I was in Maryland, and it's this one lady. This lady was saying how she was, well, number one, she was wrong for saying how she's seeking tongues. And so this one other lady said, oh, said, I can help you receive tongues because I have a gift to do that. And this other lady said, yeah, she can't help it because that's how I receive. So the Holy Spirit asked me to take note of how she prayed when she prayed tongues. I said, well, number one, I noticed that it don't sound right. And the Holy Spirit said, that's what I mean. So, dear hearts, be careful who you allow to lay their hands on you in receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. Because remember now, Satan is too a copycat. He also have people he sends out to lay hands on other people. And instead of them receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, they end up receiving a demon that speaks false tongues. That do happen. So I want to warn you to be led by the Holy Spirit and just don't allow any and everybody to lay their hands on you for the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So step number three in receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit is tell the person that when you lay your hands on them, that by faith, they are to receive the Holy Ghost right now. To receive Him right now. Praise the living God. So step number four. Tell the person what to expect as he or she receives the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, they won't know what is happening when the Holy Spirit begins to move on them. Tell the person that he or she is to expect the Holy Spirit to move upon their vocal cords or vocal organs and put supernatural words on their lips, which he would have to speak out himself in cooperation with the Holy Spirit. Remember now, the person is the one who does the actual speaking. It's not the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, he gives the utterance. But man does the actual speaking. Now, some people have taught things that are unscriptural for so long that it's hard for them to break the habit of teaching them. For example, Prophet Hagin has seen someone about to speak in tongues, and the Spirit of God will be moving on their lips and vocal cords. Then he will hear someone say to that person, let the Holy Ghost talk. The Holy Ghost, he do not do the talking. It is the person receiving the Holy Ghost who is to do the talking. That's why you have to be very careful. Now, it is all right to tell the person to yield to the Holy Ghost, but you don't tell them that the Holy Ghost is the one doing the talking. I mean, that's dangerous. That will open the door for a demon to say, oh, that's my opportunity because they're waiting for someone to take over their vocal cords and do the talking. I'll talk through them. So, it is not the Holy Spirit who do the talking. It is the person receiving the Holy Spirit who is to do the talking. Now, it is all right to tell the person to yield to the Holy Spirit because, again, in Acts chapter 2, verse 4, it reads, they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Notice they were all filled, and they began to speak. In other words, the Holy Spirit gives the utterance. The person who is receiving the Holy Spirit, they do the speaking. Many people have thought, if I do the speaking, then that would just be me. Well, of course it would be you talking. It sure won't be the Holy Spirit. It sure won't be you. You're doing the talking. It sure won't be the person praying with you who would be doing the talking. And they don't do the talking. Anytime you ever speak with tongue, it will surely be you doing the talking. You doing the speaking. But the Holy Ghost, he's the one who's giving you the utterance, which is the supernatural utterance or articulate speech. You do the speaking, he gives the utterance, the articulate speech. The point is this, dear heart. The Holy Ghost doesn't take you over, so to speak, like some people who may have told you. He just don't take you over. And he don't force you to do anything. He always works in cooperation with you. Now the devil, on the other hand, he's the opposite. He forces himself on you. But you know what? The Holy Spirit, again, he works with you. But you can respond to him and follow his promptings. And he do. He prompts us. He give us. You feel within your spirit this tug, I say. It's a prompt, which is a prompting. It's the Holy Spirit prompting. He kind of giving you a little push to do something. See, he works with you. You see, he don't take you over. He works with you. So the Holy Spirit, again, he want you to respond to him and follow his prompting. He will give us the utterance, but we do the talking. See, you have to do the talking. He gives the utterance, the articulate speech. Now, nowhere in the Bible did we find that the Holy Ghost spoke in tongues. No, we do the speaking. He gives the utterance. Every scripture reference tells us that the person receiving the Holy Ghost does the talking and speaks the supernatural utterance, tongues, the Holy Spirit gives him. Now let's look at what the scripture say about the believer's role in speaking in tongues and the Holy Spirit role in giving the utterance. Go to Acts chapter 2 verse 4. It reads, they began to speak. You see, they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. You see. And then look at Acts chapter 10 verse 46. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. And then Acts chapter 9 verse 6. And when Paul had laid his hand upon them, the Holy Ghost came on them and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. See, each time you see that they spoke and the Holy Spirit gave the utterance. 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verses 2, 4, and 5. For he that speaketh in an unknown tongue speaketh not unto men, but unto God. For no man understand him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. Verse 4, he that speaketh in an unknown tongue edify himself. Verse 5, I would that you all spoke with tongues. And then look at 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verses 14, 15, and 18. And it read, for if I pray in an unknown tongue, my spirit pray, but my understanding is unfruitful. 15, what is it then? I will pray with the spirit and I will pray with the understanding. You see how the Holy Spirit works in cooperation with us. Verse 18, I thank my God I speak with tongues more than you all. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 14 verses 27 and 28. If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or at the most by three, and that by cords, and let one interpret. But if there be no interpreter, let him keep silence in the church. Now notice that every one of these scriptures shows that in receiving the Holy Ghost and in praying in tongues and in ministering tongues and public assembly, it is always the person himself that does the actual speaking, but the Holy Spirit gives the supernatural utterance. Praise God. You know, Prophet Kenneth Hagin tell this to people who have been seeking the Holy Ghost for 30 and 40 years. And they often look at him in amazement and say, wow, if I have known that I could have been speaking in tongues for the last 30 years. And they will say, you know what? I knew I had the urge. I had the promptings all the time. I just felt the Holy Spirit just nudging me to open up my mouth and to speak. And then in fact, it was all I could do to keep from speaking in tongues. That's what these people would say. But they would say, but I was waiting for the Holy Ghost to come and take my tongue over. No, that is not the Holy Spirit, dear heart. That is a demonic spirit. Remember, the Holy Spirit works in cooperation with you. Some people think that the baptism in the Holy Ghost is as if someone swallowed a small radio. And then when God gets ready, he just turns on the radio and it starts playing or speaking automatically. Mm-mm. The Holy Ghost gives us the utterance, but we do the talking. I knew I have to tell this here, what I once heard, my husband and I, when we were attending this church. The brother who was an elder in the church, which was a brother of the pastor, got up, and immediately we knew what spirit he was of. It was not of the Holy Spirit. This elder told the people, yeah, I know when a person is speaking in tongues by the Holy Spirit, because when they speak, their mouth won't move, but you see their throat move. My husband and I looked at each other like, what? And those people believed it. I said, Lord, that is a demonic spirit. That is not the Holy Spirit through the person. That is a demonic spirit. So right then and there, that told me that the tongues he spoke was not of the Holy Spirit. It was of a demon spirit that entered him, because he looked for this spirit to take over his voice and do the talking, and his mouth not moving, but his throat is. Dear heart, that is not the Holy Spirit. That is a demon spirit that have taken over that person. I just thought that was funny. My husband died. And then it was sad too, because like I said, the people believe it. But when the Spirit of God is moving on our tongue and lips, what we must do is lift our voice, and we put sound to it. You see how the Holy Spirit works in cooperation with us? If we will obey the Holy Spirit promptings, we will find ourselves speaking with tongues. You see, we must cooperate with the Holy Spirit. Speaking with tongues isn't entirely me or you. It isn't entirely the Holy Ghost either. But what it is, speaking with tongues is a cooperation between me and the Holy Spirit. You see, the Holy Spirit can't do it without me, and I can't do it without the Holy Spirit. We work together. But demon spirits are the opposite. They like to take over. They like to take control. So be careful now. If you are one, and I actually heard many ministers say this, that when they get through ministering, they couldn't tell you a thing what they said. You know, the Holy Spirit don't work like that. He works in cooperation with you. Now, I might not can tell you everything I said verbatim, because that was the Holy Spirit through me, but I can tell you something that I said, and I was aware of myself in the Holy Spirit working through me. But if you tell me you don't remember nothing, can't tell me nothing, then that lets me know that that was not the Holy Spirit working through you. That was a demonic spirit, because they love to take over and control of individuals when the Holy Spirit works in cooperation with us. Praise the living God. So step number 4 in getting people to receive the Holy Ghost is make sure you tell the person that it's the Holy Ghost, that the Holy Ghost will move upon their mouth and lip, but they are to do the speaking. The Holy Ghost will give them the supernatural utterance, but they must cooperate with the Holy Ghost in order for him to give them the supernatural utterance. They themselves, with their mouth, is speaking. You shouldn't tell them to hush up and don't say anything, but let the Holy Spirit talk. That's dangerous. Tell them, they open their mouth, and let the Holy Spirit give the utterance through them, but it's them who's going to do the speaking. But the sounds, the supernatural utterance that's going to come through them is the Holy Spirit. And they will be aware of the Holy Spirit giving them the utterance, because with their mouth, they are doing the speaking. Praise the living God. So step number 5. Now, it may be necessary to help some people get over their fears first before they can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit due to misteaching and improper instruction that have put a lot of unbelief and doubt in people's minds regarding receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So it's a good idea to get people over their fears before they can receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Many people have been told by well-meaning people that they might get something that is false or counterfeit from receiving the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And see, that's what happened to me because of my experience when I was a young girl. I thought if I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit that I would get false tongues. But the Lord had to educate me on that, and I thank him for it. There's some people have said, you know, there is a wrong spirit as well as a right spirit, and that is true. And I want to be certain that be sure that I get the right thing. You see, so here, you know, you need to explain to people that when they seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence speaking in tongues, receiving the gift of the Father, that they will not receive a wrong gift. The Father is not even going to allow it. So when I hear people talk like that, you know, it's really good to point out Luke chapter 11, verses 11 to 13. And this is what it reads. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he asks a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he should ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? Then Jesus said, if you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, Jesus said, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? You know, when I first read this when I was young, I really didn't understand what Jesus was saying. But now, the blinders are off, and I understand perfect what Jesus was saying. Because Jesus knew there will be those who will have fear in their hearts in receiving the gift of his Father, which is the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, due to the fact of hearing and knowing that there are false tongues. So here Jesus was saying in this passage of scripture, if your child asks you as a parent for bread, would you give your child a stone? Because your child know that people will give him a stone. But you being his parent and your child asking you for bread, then that child know that you are his parent and that child trusts you because that child know that you love him or her. That child know when that he asks you for bread, that you would give him or her bread and not a stone. And if your child asks you for a fish, would you give him a serpent? If your child asks you for an egg, will you offer him a scorpion? Now, our children know because we love them, and they specifically ask us because we know them, that we won't give them a serpent, a stone, or a scorpion. We give them exactly what they ask. Now, of course, they know that we would not do that. So Jesus said, if we then, being evil, and compare, and he called us evil compared to the Heavenly Father, and that is true. Now, we being evil, know how to give good gifts unto our children, then how much more will our Father give us the Holy Spirit when we ask him? Luke 11:13. We can always be assured that God, our Father, will not give us, his children, a counterfeit when we ask him for the Holy Spirit. And when Jesus spoke these words, the gift of the Holy Spirit had not been given then. Remember that now. It is a different thing entirely, of course, When a sinner is seeking the Holy Spirit, because the sinner cannot receive the Holy Spirit according to John 14:17. But if a person who is a child of God, a believer of Jesus Christ, who has submitted their heart to Jesus Christ, is seeking the Spirit of God, he is not going to receive an evil spirit. Why? Because of what Jesus has already done for us on Calvary. When Jesus died and was resurrected and went back to the Father and now sits on his right hand side, the promise of the Father has been given, which is the Holy Spirit, the gift of the Holy Spirit. So the Father has already given the gift, but at the time Jesus was saying the word, the gift of the Holy Spirit was not given, but now he is given. So if I am a child of God, a believer, and I'm asking the Father for the gift of the Holy Spirit, which he have already gave us, he's on this earth, then that's what we're going to receive, his gift, and he's not going to allow us to receive an evil spirit. Now notice that Jesus used the word serpent and scorpion in Luke chapter 11. So turning to Luke chapter 10:19, we can also read when Jesus said, "Behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy." You see? So Jesus used the term serpents and scorpions to talk about evil spirits. So he said, Jesus said in Luke 11, you're not going to get a serpent or a scorpion, that's an evil spirit, when you ask for the Holy Spirit. Why? Because the Father have already sent the promise, and which is the Holy Spirit, to his children. So if we are a child of God and we go to our Heavenly Father to receive the Holy Spirit, then that is what we are going to get, the Holy Spirit. We are not going to get an evil spirit when you are a child of God. Praise the living God. You know, when Prophet Hagin gave these scriptures to those who have been misled by false teaching, then he noticed that he seen immediately a lot of people begin to speak with tongues. And they later told Prophet Hagin, if I known that, I could have been speaking with tongues and could have known the fullness of the Spirit for many years. They said, but I was afraid I might get a wrong spirit. But they said, thank God we can be relieved of our fears through the word of God. Right now, you under the sound of my voice, you can be relieved. Released from your fears of receiving serpents and scorpions, which is evil spirit, when you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Because your Heavenly Father have already given the gift or the promise, which is the Holy Spirit, to us. And just like you in the natural would not give a serpent and a scorpion and stones to your children, you would give them exactly what they asked of. Why? Because you love them. And that's why your children don't fear when they come to you and ask you a thing, because they know you as a loving parent would give them that which they need. They don't have to worry about receiving the wrong thing. Same thing with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Your Heavenly Father has already given him the gift to us to receive. Now we just reach out and receive him. And that's exactly who we will receive, the Holy Spirit. Not a serpent, not a scorpion, which is considered to be an evil spirit. So step number 5. And getting people to receive the Holy Spirit is to help the person to get over their fears in receiving the Holy Ghost. Refer them to Luke 11 chapter verse 11 to 13. Explain that to them, that their Heavenly Father who loved them dearly have already given them the gift of the Holy Spirit to receive. And they don't have to have no fear in receiving a serpent or a scorpion or an evil spirit. Praise God. Now, step number 6. Tell the candidate to open their mouth and be ready to use their own mouth and vocal cords. For the Holy Spirit will give the utterance, but they must yield and give voice to that utterance. At the same time, the believers should tell God in their hearts, Father, I thank you that I am receiving the Holy Spirit right now. by faith. Praise God. You know, I would give scripture further in this lesson why a person receiving the Holy Ghost shouldn't speak one word in their native language. So we're going to talk about that later. Then when the Holy Spirit begins to move upon the believer, they are to lift their voice and speak out whatever utterance is given to them by the Holy Spirit, regardless of what it sounds like. The candidate should begin to speak the words and the language the Holy Spirit gives them, continuing to praise God and speak to God with those supernatural words until the language becomes more and more fluent. When that person can hear themselves speak in tongues in a distinct language, they will have assurance and confidence that they have received the Holy Ghost. And that's exactly what happened to me. Because when those sounds, that utterance, and distinct language started coming up, my ears heard it, and my eyes saw my mouth speaking, but also my ears heard that utterance come forth. I was amazed. I was like, wow. And I knew that was the Holy Spirit through me speaking utterance unto my Heavenly Father. I knew, dear heart, that I was in a conversation with my Heavenly Father. Now, my mind didn't know what I was saying, but my spirit did. My spirit was in conversation by the Holy Spirit with my Heavenly Father. I felt it, dear heart. I heard it. I saw it. And it was amazing. It was awesome. And I was in his loving arms. And just like I remember when my babies were born, I took my babies and I cradled them because I love them. And I felt like that was happening to me. My Heavenly Father just took me and cradled me in his arms. And I put in the natural, was in a fetal position. And I felt such peace. That peace that passed all understanding, that I can't even describe. The presence of the Father just pure peace. And all I can remember doing is like I was, you know, a baby taking, you hold your baby in your arms and they're taking cool in your arms, like, that's the love that they feel. Where I felt such love from my Heavenly Father that I kept saying, oh, that was so awesome, dear heart. But that is exactly what happened to me. So if you go to John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39, it reads, "In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And he that believe on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly," well, that means his spirit, "shall flow rivers of living water. But this spoke he of the Spirit, which they believe on him should receive, for the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now the Bible says the Holy Spirit will come to us as rain. And Jesus said in John chapter 7 that we are to come and drink of the Holy Spirit. In other words, dear heart, Jesus is saying receiving the Holy Ghost is just like drinking water. And that is exactly what I experienced too. That is the same principle that is involved. The point is, no one can drink water with their mouth shut. Try drinking water with your mouth closed. And dear heart, on this particular video broadcast, I don't go into detail of my testimony regarding the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But if you go to www.blogtalkradio.com/thechildrensmic, and I may have mentioned it in 7 Steps to Receiving the Holy Ghost or another program, but be sure to listen to all of the Holy Spirit in His Gift series on Blog Talk. And I do talk about my experience when I received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, for those of you who desire to hear it. And also, in the same way, in order to receive the Holy Spirit, a person must put action to their faith and give voice to the unction of the Holy Spirit. He can't do that with his mouth closed. You just can't do it with your mouth closed. You have to have your mouth open. Remember, the Holy Spirit gives the utterance We, the person, we do the actual talking. Secondly, no one can drink and talk at the same time. You know, Prophet Hagin have seen people come to receive the Holy Spirit and open their mouth in faith. That's how you do, open your mouth in faith. He have never seen anyone who opened their mouth in faith to receive the Holy Spirit who didn't receive as quickly as you can snap your finger. So just open your mouth in faith to receive. It's like in the natural, you pick up a glass of water. You must open your mouth to drink the water. But in this case, it's by faith that you open your mouth. Then Prophet Hagin said he have seen thousands upon thousands of people filled with the Holy Ghost, preachers and pastors of every denomination, doctors and lawyers, school teachers, college professors, laborers, farmers, and people from every walk of life. And one time he saw five businessmen come down the aisle and in one of his meetings to receive the Holy Spirit, and they all opened their mouth in faith that they were going to receive the Holy Spirit. And guess what, dear heart? They all were filled. Why? Because it was by faith that they opened their mouth to receive. It's like in the natural, you drink, pick up your glass, open your mouth, drink your water, you swallow. Dear heart, you got to hear my testimony. So be sure you go to Blog Talk Radio and tune into my testimony. It will encourage you and bless you. Now, that's scripture because Jesus said, come and drink. That's what Jesus said. He said, come and drink. John 7, chapter verse 37. So if we will act on God's word, he always honor his word. If we will act on it, he will honor our word. And we can receive the Holy Ghost or whatever it is that he has promised. Because he always honors faith. So step number 6 in receiving the Holy Ghost, tell the candidate to open their mouth and be ready to use their own mouth and vocal cords. For the Holy Spirit will give the utterance, but they must yield and give voice to that utterance. And then at the same time, in their heart, tell God, I am receiving right now by faith the Holy Spirit. Praise the living God. So step number 7, tell the candidate of the person to keep their focus and prevent the candidate from being distracted. For instance, don't permit a crowd to gather around a candidate giving instruction all at one time. Everybody giving the person instruction. That's confusion and that's distraction. You know, Prophet Hagin said he liked to have only a few workers whom he has specially instructed to help people receive the Holy Spirit. And that is wise for us to do today, especially if you are a pastor of a church or maybe you are an apostle. It's best to have certain people who have been instructed in how to get people filled with the Holy Spirit. Because if not, the enemy will send different ones and giving that individual instruction, and it would be a distraction and it would confuse the person. Because many times people are a little slow about yielding to the Spirit, but if someone is there to help encourage them to yield to the Holy Spirit, people can receive more quickly. For example, just like when going swimming, sometimes it's hard to get some people in the water. But if we would take the lead and get in the water ourselves and swim around and say, the water sure feels good, and that happened to me as a child, they would be encouraged to get in the water. And we all, you know, probably have experienced that where we was hesitant in getting in the water, but someone else would get in the water. And they're like, man, this water is great once you get in. So, and then you start seeing them having such a great time. And next thing you know, you've been coaxed to jump on in. You're like, oh, yeah, I'm so glad I jumped in. This is fun. So similarly, sometimes, you know, you can simply speak in tongues yourself after praying with the person. And this will encourage the person to follow you into the water, so to speak. which is into the baptism of the Holy Spirit. That don't mean you tell that person to repeat after me. You don't do that. Now, Hagin, he said that he had been in four gospel circles for more than 50 years. And now, I'm pretty sure he has seen nearly everything happen that you can mention when people were seeking the Holy Ghost. And he said he's seen a lot that he refused to even mention. And again, on Blog Talk Radio, I give my experience on that as well. For example, he said, Prophet Hagin said he has seen people at the altar seeking the Holy Spirit while someone was on one side yelling in their ear, "Hold on, brother, hold on." Then somebody else might be hollering in the other ear, saying to the brother, "Turn loose, brother, turn loose." Now, he actually seen this. And someone else kneeling right behind that person will be patting the brother on the back, hollering, "Let go, brother, let go." Then someone sitting right in front of them would be shouting something else at the top of their voice. Now, you see, all those people were a distraction. That was confusion. And the Holy Spirit is not author of confusion. We know who the author of confusion, that's the enemy. So the enemy was serving as a distraction to keep his brother from being filled with the Holy Spirit. So that's the reason why you who are congregation leaders, you have to use wisdom in teaching others to work your altars so that they can, you know, help people in receiving the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And always allow one person to give the instruction, not all the altar workers at the same time. Because I actually seen that myself, where all the altar workers giving the person instruction. And the instruction is totally different. And that causes confusion. But no, you have one person assigned. And the other altar workers can pray. Many have still received the Holy Spirit this way, not because of this kind of behavior, but in spite of. However, even though multitudes have received, many honest and sincere believers have been driven away and they did not receive. Now, we will see some people filled with the Holy Spirit if we would follow. Well, we will see more people filled with the Holy Spirit if we will follow scriptural practices. Therefore, dear Lord, don't allow several people to crowd around candidates who are seeking the Holy Spirit, and don't allow more than one person to give instructions at one time, because that would cause the candidate to become confused and it would serve as a distraction. Let one person instruct him or her how to yield to the Spirit. If others are standing nearby, then like I said, have them pray quietly in tongues and not in their own language. If people are praying in their own native language, that person receiving the Holy Spirit can hear what they are saying, and it will distract that person. In other words, that person might get their mind on the others and what they are saying. And many times people will not yield to God if they are listening to what other people around them are saying. So if you do have a crowd around you, let one person instruct the candidate in how to yield to the Holy Spirit while others pray in tongues, not the native language, because that person who receiving is listening. Just like swimming, person jumps in the water and you tell them how good it feels in this water, that'll coax them to want to jump in the water. Same thing with a person receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues. If the people around them, that's what happened to me, if the people around them are speaking in tongues, I was listening to them speak in tongues. So that helped me to keep my focus on the Holy Spirit coming up through me and enabling me to speak with tongues. And that helped me, that coached me. Praise God. So step number 7 to helping people to receive the Holy Ghost is to keep the candidate from being distracted. Don't allow the candidate to be distracted. Praise God. Now, we will find that by following these 7 steps, we will help believers receive the Holy Spirit immediately without tarrying or waiting. As we assist believers in receiving the Holy Spirit, we will feel personally blessed and rewarded for our part in their receiving this wonderful gift of the Holy Ghost. Praise God. Dear hearts, again, I want to say thank you for tuning in to Speak the Living Word TV broadcast, and tune in again. And I hope this teaching series has been a blessing to you. And dear hearts, again, in all you're getting, be sure to get understanding. Shalom. And we are